This is Duke University.
Thank you. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Our preacher this morning is Dr. Paula Gilbert. Dr. Gilbert is Dean of Continuing Studies and of Summer Session, so you can imagine this is quite a busy time of year for her. She's preached here at the chapel many times before, but not, I gather, for 20 years. So it's a wonderfully warm welcome back to Dr. Gilbert as our preacher. Let's stand and praise the living God.
Thank you.
how great a flame aspires, kindled by a spark of grace. It spurs us onward and reminds us, Lord, to keep the faith. We have fallen short, but yet we look with confidence to the mercy of God. Now let us confess our sins to God. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Sin's strongholds Christ now overthrows, shaking the trembling gates of hell, your sins are forgiven. Receive his pardon and peace to stand in his strength alone, now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us now share in the blessed love, signs and words of peace with one another. Peace be with you.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination printed in your bulletin. God, our Savior, look on this wounded world in pity and in power. And as your word is proclaimed, hold us fast to your promises of peace won for us by your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from Isaiah, the 55th chapter. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there until they've watered the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy and be led back in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall burst into song, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress, instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle. And it shall be to the Lord for a memorial, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The lesson is from Matthew, the 13th chapter. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the lake. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there while the crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Some seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60-fold, and some 30. Let anyone with ears listen. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with great joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a short while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and yet another 30. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Listen, a sower went out to sow. Thus begins a decisive turning point in Matthew's Gospel. Earlier in the Gospel, Jesus teaches the disciples and the crowds from a mountaintop. But now Jesus is somewhere along the sea, and when the crowds gather, he gets up and gets into and sits in a boat and begins to teach. In contrast to that previous time of teaching on the mountain, when he was all about offering pronouncements about salt and light, the law and the prophets, adultery, divorce, loving one's enemies and praying for those who persecute you. In contrast to those previous pronouncements, Jesus is now said to tell the people many things about the kingdom of heaven in parables. Listen, he says, a sower went out to sow. And so begins another extended section of teaching, this one about the kingdom of heaven in parables. You know them. They're generally familiar. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. The kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. The kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea. Now, if you read Matthew's gospel from its beginning, you encounter the proclamation of the kingdom of heaven over and over again. John the Baptist, the one who is the forerunner, John appears in the wilderness preaching, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And after John is arrested, Jesus leaves Nazareth and begins traveling throughout Galilee, curing every disease, curing every sickness among the people, and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom. In teaching about prayer, Jesus' words to his disciples are these: "When you pray, say, 'Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come.'" In the Gospels of Mark and Luke, the term used most often is the kingdom of God, whereas here in Matthew, the gospel we're working through this year, the term is the kingdom of heaven. But whether it is the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God, the proclamation of the kingdom itself is at the heart of Jesus' preaching and teaching and his healing. In the church's calendar, we are several Sundays now into the season of Pentecost, which in an earlier age was referred to as Kingdom Tide. But my question is, where is the church's proclamation of the kingdom today? Where do we engage its power and its mystery? What do we know of the power of the kingdom, a power that compelled Simon Peter and Andrew, James and John and Mary Magdalene to leave everything that was familiar and to follow Jesus? And where is that mystery of the kingdom, a mystery that Jesus compared to a grain of mustard seed and to a grain of wheat growing among the weeds? Have we so domesticated the kingdom of heaven that we have made the kingdom merely a matter of church growth and good deeds? Have we so reduced the kingdom, removing it to the periphery of our faith, that we simply are able to ignore it? And have we become so disappointed and so discouraged that we can no longer hope and pray for the coming of God's kingdom? As Americans, you and I know all about the domestication of and the reduction of and the disappointment over ideals that fail to be realized. In 1630, John Winthrop challenged a group of Puritan immigrants with a vision of the Massachusetts Bay Colony as a city upon the hill, one that would be a light to the nations. And in the early 20th century, it was Walter Rauschenbusch proclaiming the social gospel from Hell's Kitchen in New York City. And in the mid-20th century, it was Martin Luther King preaching about a beloved community where race would no longer divide. But today, all those dreams are simply relics of history and virtually forgotten. And perhaps it is no wonder that we in the 21st century have domesticated and reduced the kingdom of heaven into a religious version of a political stump speech, one in which we know the promises made will never be kept. But listen, Jesus says, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. And other seeds fell on rocky ground where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60-fold, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen. Birds, rocky ground, thorns, we can imagine them all, can't we? No matter how citified we have become, we have seen seeds consumed by birds, or seeds that struggle to grow when cast on rocky ground or among thorns. And we've seen the difference that good soil can make. The parable itself seduces us to focus our imaginations upon the soils. And from there, it's a simple matter to start associating with the soils, with how they both individually and corporately represent the Word of God as it's variously received. And even if we were not naturally inclined in this direction, Jesus seems to lead us down this path with a soil-by-soil explanation himself. And before you know it, we have domesticated this parable into a parable of soils and reduced it in a way that it is about how the various soils are to be associated with the many failures and the sometimes success of the evangelical mission. Read in this way, the parable no doubt comforted the early church when that church was persecuted and heresies arose and promising converts turned back to their old faiths. Read in this way, the parable no doubt comforts us when our efforts to live our faith fail to achieve the goals we set or to make a discernible difference in our communities and our world. But let me suggest to you that this parable is not so much about the soils as it is a parable about the sower. Listen, Jesus says, a sower went out to sow. Who is the sower? Is the sower the church? Is the sower the disciples? Is the sower one or all of us? No, the sower is not the church, and the sower is not the disciples, and the sower is certainly not one of us. The sower is none other than God the Father, who in the beginning created the heavens and the earth, when the earth was a formless void and there was only darkness. In the beginning, it was the mighty wind of God sweeping over the face of the waters that began bringing forth life. In John's gospel, we learn that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. Surely this Word, whom we believe came into the world in flesh in Jesus, surely this Word is, by the power of the Holy Spirit, God's seed cast abundantly and flung far across the world. Cast upon hard paths, cast upon rocky ground, cast among the thorns, and cast upon good soil. Jesus, the Word of God, is God's seed sown upon the earth and sown everywhere. You heard it this morning in the Old Testament reading, the way that Isaiah puts it. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there until they have watered the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and succeed in the thing for which I sent it. If God the Father is a sower in this parable, And if God's Son, Jesus, is the seed, then the parable is not about us. It's not about our failures and our oftentimes weak successes. If the parable is about God the Father and about God the Son, it is about a kingdom of heaven that embraces us, but is not defined by us. It is about a kingdom of heaven that incorporates us, but one that's not measured by us. It's about a kingdom of heaven that is a kingdom of power and a kingdom of grace and a kingdom of mercy. It's a parable about the death of seeds and about the surprising growth of grain. And it is a parable about the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And by extension, it is a parable about our own death and our resurrection when we are baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. In John's Gospel, Jesus puts it this way, "Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit." Listen, Jesus says, a sower went out to sow. The kingdom of heaven is, in the beginning and at the last, God's will for God's creation, expressed in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus the Christ. The kingdom is the seed that dies, yet in dying it springs forth in new life. And because the kingdom is God's, it is neither turned aside nor defeated by hard ground or rocky places or thorns. The kingdom, by the power of the Holy Spirit, is the seed springing up in far-flung places, in the Sudan, in China, in Haiti, in Uganda. And the kingdom is in this place this morning when we reach out our hands to receive the bread and wine, the body and blood of Christ Jesus our Lord and the Word of God. The kingdom of heaven is in this place when with hands outstretched, we offer ourselves to be the soil receiving the seed of God in Christ. The kingdom of heaven, in the beginning and at the last, is God's kingdom, God's power and God's grace and God's mystery. Listen, Jesus says, a sower went out to sow. Thanks be to God. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. God of a purpose and a plan, you spoke to Isaiah saying, "Your word shall not return empty, but it shall accomplish that which you purpose." Give us hope in the purpose and plan you have for each and every one of us. Bring to fruition every kernel of truth you speak to us. Endow us with patient and fervent hope, even when it feels difficult. Encourage those who await a message from you. Though it may seem a lifetime, strengthen the faith of the weary. Make your grace live in your people. As rain and snow nourish the earth, let us not return to you above until we have succeeded in the thing for which you sent us. Bring forth and sprout your living truth, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater. Embolden us with a vibrant trust that surpasses all understanding, a blessed peace that only you can bring. Lead the discouraged back in peace. We bring before you those who may feel constricted by thorns and briars. Carry to them the cypress and myrtle as signs of hope and your blessed assurance. Lord, in your mercy. Jesus, our good teacher, in the parable of the sower, you offer four responses to your truth by the hearts of your people. Grant wisdom to hearts seeking greater understanding, to hearts representing rocky ground. Grant a strong foundation to stand upon in time of trouble or persecution. Be with any who land among thorns and struggle to find life in the midst of fierce landscapes. Bless any who are persecuted or who live in the midst of violence. Walk alongside people in the midst of the founding of South Sudan, those in the midst of struggle in Syria, and amongst the conflicts of Libya. Lord Jesus, give sustaining strength to the one among the thorns for whom the cares of the world seem to choke with great power. Make us a people who represent the good earth. May we nourish and sustain your people and your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Loving Father God, you show us your loving emphasis on family in the story of families like that of Isaac and Rebecca. Strengthen couples in the midst of struggle. Be with all who have difficulty living into their marriage vows. Cherish any who long for children, and bring comfort to all those who face financial ruin. Breathe your spirit into homes that know emotional cruelty and physical danger. Walk among any who have known harm at the hand of one they love. Make your grace known to all those who perpetuate that harm. Give hope to your children yearning to break long-time patterns. Give those living amidst emotional cruelty and physical danger the friends and family support that they need to seek and find the refuge. Father God, protect the children living daily in pain-stricken homes. Bring peace and comfort to any who know the pain of child cruelty. Grant your perseverance and hope to people and organizations working to end domestic violence. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, you answer prayer, and it is in this knowledge that we lift our prayers to you. We know our words have not fallen on deaf ears, but as you purpose it, so shall it come to pass. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Now let us offer our gifts unto God. Amen.
Thank you. Spirit moves in my heart, I'm gonna sing till the Spirit moves in my heart, I'm gonna sing till the Spirit moves in my heart, I'm gonna sing till Jesus comes. I'm gonna sing till the Spirit moves in my heart, I'm gonna sing till the Spirit moves in my heart, I'm gonna sing till the Spirit moves in my heart, I'm gonna sing till Jesus comes.
Ministers will be in the memorial chapel to my right during the sharing of communion. If you have come to the chapel this morning with a heavy heart, either on your own behalf or thinking about a loved one, they'll be glad to pray with you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Creator God, you made this earth of paths and rocks and thorns and soil. To Abraham you promised fertile land, and to Moses you promised blessing and freedom. In your prophets you called your people to cultivate the promises of your land and cherish the blessings of your freedom. In Jesus you gave us your superabundant soil, allowing yourself to be plowed and broken open, that we might be restored, replenished, and renewed, to be planted again as your good seed in this earth. And so we gladly thank you with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, singing the hymn of your unending praise. Abundant God, from your good soil, you make enough and plenty to feed and inspire all your children, and out of your earth you bring the glory of resurrection life. Come among us now through the power of the Spirit, that we may be transformed into your likeness, and that these gifts of bread and wine may become for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, who on the night he was betrayed at supper with his disciples took bread, gave you thanks, broke the bread, and gave it to them saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup. Again, he gave you thanks and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Transforming God, where your children are in the grip of evil and bewilderment, bring them your courage and clarity. Where your children are without deep root and facing trouble or persecution, give them patience and endurance. Where your children are burdened by the cares of the world and tempted by the lure of wealth, offer them wisdom and understanding. And where your children bear fruit and yield, make that fruit so plentiful that it may feed all in your world who hunger for faith, for hope, or for love. Sanctify your groaning creation, that your universe may breathe your breath and be filled with your life anew, that we may love what you love and do what you would do, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, ever one God.
Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory.
As a green blade riseth from buried grain, so from your broken body, Lord Christ, make your people live again. God in Christ has made himself food for us. Come and be made God's food for the world.
Thank you.
Almighty God, we give you thanks for the life of this university and especially today for the Center for Documentary Studies. We bless you for the creativity and the power that documentary stories have to bring divisions, to bridge divisions and differences, and to advance understanding, respect, and dignity. God, only wise, you delight to make your people out of food, and the food out of which you make us is your body and blood. As we have become your body in the eating of food, bless those with whom we share food this week, and bless those with whom we share you and in whom we meet you, that in being made your body, we may become food for your world, and through the change they see in us, all may come to praise the glories of your name. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.